It is time to lift another veil. There seems to be no end to the lies. It is important to understand that a science can be constructed out of almost anything. The indoctrination of heliocentrism and its subsequent scientific fields are primarily metaphysical and not rooted in the physical, observable world we inhabit. The satanic cabal could have easily told us that the Earth was shaped like an oblong or triangle, and entire sciences and mathematical equations would have been dedicated to explaining this. Good science fiction works in the same way. The science adds up, but it doesn't make it a reality. Our reality is not governing the field of heliocentrism. We experience nothing that suggests our Earth is a globe. No, rather it is a concept or idea that is governing heliocentrism and leading many scientists further astray from discovering real truth. The perceivable world is at odds with scientific theory. It is deliberate deception. And this deception is also present in our geological understanding of Earth's flat plane. Throughout cultures, we come across mythological stories of creatures being turned to stone. The most famous of these is the legend of Medusa, who had snakes in place of hair and whose glance would turn people to stone. The tales are found in European, Native American, Asian, Ancient Greek and Oceania culture. The stories often feature serpents or basilisks. Many believe they are our ancestors' ways of explaining petrification. Here are images of petrified animals, and here are some images of petrified wood from Petrified Forest National Park in Arizona. We are told by the scientist priests of the world that organic living matter petrifies in two ways. The trees became petrified when buried in sediment, like thick mud, or in volcanic ash. Look closer at the petrified trees. They haven't just turned to stone, but are composed of crystals. A cataclysm such as a mud flood or volcanic eruption literally turned wood and living matter into crystals. The object, we are told, needs to be impacted so oxygen and bacteria cannot reach the matter to begin decomposing it. Yeah, right. Why we believe such nonsense in the first place is beyond me. We bury our dead and they decompose. They do not turn to stone or crystal. And a volcanic eruption produces volcanic ash. This ash is destructive, as Wikipedia tells us. It can affect human and animal health. It can disrupt electrical systems. It can destroy aeroplanes and buildings, ranging from complete or partial collapse of roofing. And yet scientists tell us it is this same volcanic ash that is responsible for the phenomenon of wood petrification. Thousands have died at the hands of volcanic eruption. Why don't we see petrified human bodies of crystal? Why do the victims decay? And it isn't the lava. Lava would melt bone. Volcanic ash does not cause petrification. This petrified wood is laying out almost intact and neatly for the world to see. It also appears that they have been cut into tidy chunks. Did the ash or sediment also chop this wood before turning it into beautiful crystal? And if not, then please find me the ancient saws that can cut through stone and crystal. This is nothing more than mere theatre for the gullible. Sediment and volcanic ash does not explain petrification properly. A frog does not just turn into stone. You can even find petrified honeycomb and beehives. During the course of its life, the bumblebee will buzz to and fro, collecting nectar and pollen from the flowers. It can detect both the presence and pattern of electric fields of the flowers. It does this to gather information on the flower and find out if it has recently been visited by another bee. Once they have collected enough nectar and pollen, they return to the nest and deposit this into wax cells. These wax cells are constructed into symmetrical, hexagonal forms. The honeycomb is a mass of hexagonal prismatic wax. The bees have an innate intelligence to construct their honeycombs with hexagonal tiling because it creates equal-sized cells while minimizing the total perimeter of the cells. In other words, it is economical. It uses the least material to create a lattice of cells. The geometric efficiency of the hexagon can be seen everywhere in nature. The dragonfly's eyes are composed with hexagonal efficiency. Look, the hexagon is everywhere. No two snowflake patterns are the same, but they all share the same fundamental hexagonal geometry. And then there is the case of flax plant stems. As you can see, each individual fiber is hexagonal in shape. This is not an accident. No Kabbalah, Ein Sof randomness, luck of the draw. This is intelligent design. The natural world grows and develops with efficiency. The stem consists of hexagonal columns that allow it to grow upwards. And the result is this. Beautiful plants and trees grow upward towards the sky. When we look at tree rings under a microscope, we see similar geometric patterns of the hexagon. Microscopic photographs of petrified wood shows these same hexagonal columns. But according to the scientific priests, there exist anomalies in our world. The basalt columns, perfect hexagonal columns that mirror the tight efficiency we see in organic living matter. Wikipedia and mainstream science tell us that columnar basalt formed due to the cooling of magma or lava flows. This is what lava looks like when active. And this is what it looks like when it has cooled and hardened. So how did magma or lava cool down and form hexagonal shapes so perfect in their geometric symmetry? This is Giant's Causeway in Ireland. Does it look like magma lava form these huge, perfectly shaped hexagonal columns? I want you to imagine that you are a child again, beset with curiosity at the wonders of the world. What do you see? Devil's Tower in northeastern Wyoming. The world's most famous structure of basalt columns. A pilgrimage for rock climbers who venture up the seemingly endless chimneys between the columns. They tell us it was formed by igneous lava. What do you see now? I know what you see. Traces of old volcanic magma that cooled and formed a rock mesa. We weren't even given a chance. We all know this film. Steven Spielberg weaving his sorcery and solidifying the satanic name. Devil's Tower, and pushing the alien agenda on us once again. Constant distraction. It wasn't always called this. The Native Americans called it Mateo Tepe, or Great Bear Lodge, and there is entire folklore surrounding it. It wasn't until 1875 that Richard Irving Dodge gave it a satanic name. and which President Roosevelt immortalized in 1906 when he designated it the first US national monument. This is not solidified lava flow. It is the remains of a giant silicon-based tree. This is the real petrified tree, and this is the distraction, the control, the lie. These were not formed from volcanic ash. They are remnants. Tiny branches and twigs from something much larger and long forgotten. Look closer as these climbers venture upwards. You can see the individual hexagonal towers, much like the individual hexagonal fibers. Some fibers become loose over time and break away from the overall mass. Look closer at the cracks and broken parts of the outer stem. It's petrified epidermis, the layer of cells that cover the stems, much like our connective tissue fascia. The stems do not enter the ground horizontally, but bend into the ground like the base of a tree. Look at the plant's stem flax again. See how the mass becomes smaller at the edges. Now look, we see the same thing here. Imagine the climber who thought of nothing else but rocks and never saw the tree. Look at the other basalt column wonders of the world. Please tell me how magma or lava formed this. Did the magma flow just stop in midair and begin to cool and solidify into these hexagonal columns? Just as divine creation gave other organisms the innate intelligence of hexagonal efficiency, these columns were part of living trees. Our flat earth is fractal. It is a case of the microcosm and the macrocosm. A great, majestic wonder with nothing similar in sight for miles around it. Lava could not have formed this even if it tried. But you didn't notice, did you? Can you not see it? We were born with sight and we've become blind. Your eyes have become traitors over time. Look closer. The top is flat. This tree was cut down. And this was just a small one. These giant tree stumps are literally everywhere. Look. Not all of them were cut down. Only the really good ones. Others were blasted, torn, and laid down. Look. Why were these trees cut down? What on earth happened? The basalt columns are likely a particular kind of plant, and not all of the giant trees of the world are formed from basalt columns, but other silicon structures. The giant trees were diverse in species and type, much like we see in our trees today. Not all of what we've learned to call mountains are giant trees. Eyes exposed to the light take time to adjust, but you will start to spot the difference. This is not a volcano. It's a pile of loose waste that was generated and piled up by giant machines. It has a perfect cone shape, like all loose structures. Lava and volcanic ash contain high levels of silica. They piled the grounded silicon and chemical waste of their activities here. These chemicals sometimes react with each other, and sometimes burn. Any farmer will tell you compost heaps can start to heat up to the point of spontaneous combustion. The microcosm and the macrocosm. Silicon is the second most abundant element found in Earth's crust after oxygen. Silicon is structurally very similar to carbon. Many scientists have theorized that silicon-based life is possible. When silicon interacts with oxygen, it turns into quartz. This is a carbon-based tree, and this is a silicon-based tree. History is a lie. There was a silicon era in which trees grew to enormous heights, and they were made primarily of crystal, just like quartz. What we call rocks today are really just fragments of old giant trees and other living organisms. Rocks and stone are the phase between silicon and carbon life forms. There are no petrified organisms, just the remains of silicon era organisms. More than 75% of the Earth's volcanoes reside in the Ring of Fire, a major area in the basin of the Pacific Ocean, the deepest ocean on Earth. Look at this image of our oceans without water. You can see the scarring and trenches on the ocean's floor. This is where they dug and mined the most. The Ring of Fire is home to the deepest trench on Earth, the Mariana Trench. It measures 2,550 kilometers in length and is over 10,000 meters deep. Look at all the other trenches in this area. It is not a coincidence that the largest volcano on Earth, the Tamu Massive, is located right next to these trenches under the water. It is the size of the United Kingdom. The extent of the mining here has created 452 ocean waste piles, or what they call volcanoes. You see, there never used to be oceans on Earth like we know them now. What is now the oceans was once covered in deep silicon crystal. All life was primarily silicon-based. Silicon does not need water to grow. It is very different from the carbon-based life that we know of and experience as humans. Only carbon-based life needs water to survive. Scientists have found an unusual amount of carbon in the ice of the Earth's poles that dates back thousands of years. This high amount of carbon in the ice shouldn't be there. They tell us its recent presence is because of burning fossil fuels since the Industrial Revolution, but that doesn't explain the carbon that dates back thousands of years. It suggests there was a huge worldwide fire at some point in our history. Carbon was brought into Earth. Silicon is usually bound with oxygen. We are told that in order to reduce the silicon to its purest state, which means removing the oxygen molecules, carbon must be used. Silicon is purified through a reaction with carbon in the form of coal, charcoal, and heating to 2,000 degrees in a furnace. They mined the silicon out of Earth and harvested the giant silicon trees and used a vast amount of carbon to purify the silicon. Our oceans contain 38,000 gigatons of carbon. 1 gigaton equals to 1 billion tons. But silicon is the second most abundant element in the Earth's crust. Carbon presence in the Earth's crust is actually very low. Carbon life was never meant to be. Earth would never have favored carbon-based life over other possible choices. A creator would never have favored carbon over silicon. Silicon would form an unbelievable, beautiful world. It binds to oxygen 5 times stronger than carbon. Carbon is weaker and combined with many other elements. Because of this, our lives are short and susceptible to disease. But again, not all mountains are trees. There is a reason you can feel completely changed spiritually and physically in some parts of the mountains and then feel a sense of the barrenness in other parts. This is a cuttlefish, the largest bucket wheel excavator in the world today. The rotary excavator works by scraping the land and leaving a concave wall of stone. Look at these cliffs in Australia. They are called a wonder of the world, the wave rock. But can you see the resemblance? It is not a wave of rock. It is the scars of giant rotary excavation. We can find representations of gigantic machines in the pre-Spanish pottery displayed in Costa Rica and San Francisco. Imagine you are a rural inhabitant and you see one of these, much more gigantic in scale, and for the first time. You would too think they were some kind of mythical monster. Look at Tula, the ancient capital city of Toltec. They revered these beings and paid homage to them with sculptures on top of their half pyramids. Look closer at their hands. They look like they're holding drills or power tools. Look at this drawing. It depicts beings in some kind of metallic suit, with helmets that cover their entire face for protection, and what looks like to be swords in their hands. We are told these artifacts were made before metal was discovered, but that is clearly a lie. Look at these images of quarries. You see the tiered, stepped structure. It is a formed structure with right angles when viewed from above. The excavators take huge chunks of land, and this is the remaining result. They have lied about everything. What they call ravines, cliffs, valleys are nothing more than quarries. Look at the valley passages and limestone cliffs that border it. Massive chunks of land were excavated and carved out. Now look at the rest of our world. Quarried tiered stone. You can still see the traces of machines' tracks on the ground as they gutted the land. It is a wasteland. In some old quarries, there is a lot of moisture, and people are able to do farming, and plants regrow. This is not a lake. This is a flooded quarry. Look at the Caspian Sea. It is a giant flooded quarry. And these quarries are literally everywhere. Tibet Mountains. A 6,000 meter quarry. Grand Canyon National Park in America. Huge quarry. Lake Louise in Canada. Flooded quarry. The Red River Gorge in America. Quarry. The Peak District in England, a quarry with new growth. The Highlands in Scotland, a tiered quarry system. Snowdonia in Wales, a flooded quarry system. Blue Mountains in Australia, a huge gutted quarry. the Blue Mountains again. Compare this wall to the human marble mining in the Alps. We have to wake up. Tongariro National Park in New Zealand. Quarried waste heap. Utah State Park, a huge quarry. Bugatti Mountains, quarry waste. Zermatt Glacier in Switzerland, a quarried path with scarred tracks. Rainbow Mountain in Peru, a quarry heap full of chemicals. Luna Crater Lake in Iceland, a flooded quarry. Namibia Desert, vast quarried waste. Egyptian Desert, the bottom layer is totally scraped out. Nothing grows here. There is no soil left. Deserts are completely artificial. They are the result of giant scale mining activities so barbaric that they removed all soil and living life. Australia is a huge quarry with barely any soil, just red dust. The Sahara Desert is gigantic quarry waste. What is sand? It is silica or silicon dioxide. Sand is grounded, fine silicon dust. Just like we see sawdust when cutting down carbon trees. It is the remains of the silicon trees. Baltic amber often washes up on the shores of the Baltic Sea. Amber is fossilized tree resin. 90% of the world's amber comes from here. There is so much amber in the oceans, it shouldn't be there. It is the waste of the large-scale mining of Earth's old gigantic trees. There is not an area on Earth that throughout history has not been mined. There are no natural rocks, mountains, cliffs, ravines, plateaus, canyons, deserts on Earth. Earth is not a spinning planet that's evolved over time. It is an old, flat quarry. They have lied to us about everything and hidden the true barbaric history. A tremendous sin. Did you know that trees communicate via root systems? Through underground network systems, the wood wide web. They communicate via slow pulsing electrical signals. There exists entire cave systems of crystal under the earth. They say caves form from water erosion, but why are there gigantic crystals in so many of them? These are not caves. They are cut off root systems of our old majestic giant silicon trees. Look at the rivers of our world from above. They look like excavated tree roots because they are. They gutted our giant trees and their roots. Many river systems are actually the flooded, cut-off root systems of our old, majestic giant silicon trees. It is not a coincidence that many of our giant tree stumps are located within national parks and protected land. It means we can't dig there and discover roots attached to these structures. Hollywood have mocked us and given us a vision that is most likely very similar to Earth's true history, Look. It's interesting that the director of this movie, James Cameron, also has an obsession with diving down into the Mariana Trench. Silicon, we are told, is a powerful semiconductor. It is the primary element that makes computer chips possible. Memory chips and processors would not be possible without silicon. It holds memory. That's why they call our era the Silicon Era, and that's why it's called Silicon Valley. They came and brought in carbon so they could oxidize and retrieve pure silicon from our once beautiful world. It may have looked something like this. Why did they do this? What on earth happened? Carbon life was not supposed to be. If you look closer at the carbon element, we discover that it consists primarily of the isotope carbon-12. The carbon-12 isotope makes up 98.93% of the entire element of carbon. Carbon-12 is composed of 6 protons, 6 neutrons, and 6 electrons. Carbon is number 6 on the periodic table. It is the mark of the beast. Carbon life, human life as we know it, was created by the beast. 666. Maybe that's why humans have such an innate propensity for satanic, barbaric behavior. We must move towards truth, light, and goodness. Everything we have been told is a lie. Our entire history is a satanic fabrication, and the joke's on us. I want to show you something else. Old photographs. They said it was just for preservation and restoration. But you can make your own mind up. Thank you. I know. Come on, we have to keep going. There isn't much time left. Let's go to episode 12. We're almost there.